Hello and welcome everybody to my presentation. I'm Patrick Keller from the Security and Privacy Group at the University of Innsbruck, which is led by Rainer Böhme. Today, I want to present a small idea that came up when Martin Florian from the Humboldt University Berlin was visiting us in Austria. Our idea addresses the conflict between anonymity and effective crime prevention. On the one hand, anonymity is necessary to protect citizens from the state, but on the other hand, with too much anonymity, the state cannot protect its citizens from each other. So obviously, there's a trade-off here. We want to look at this conflict from the challenging perspective of decentralized systems. When we say decentralized system, we mean systems without central control. The lack of central control usually implies nobody dictates the rules. Especially, no single party can sneak in a de-anonymization scheme. We are mostly interested in cryptocurrencies such as Bitcoin, Ethereum, and Monero. These systems strongly rely on the peer-to-peer principle. Everybody contributes a little bit, and decisions are taken jointly following some protocol. In this setting, it is particularly unlikely that the police gets privileged access for de-anonymization. Our main objective is to solve the tension between anonymity and crime prevention in a peer-to-peer manner. So, in the very same spirit that these cryptocurrency systems are built in. We want to enable targeted prosecution of bad crimes, but we also want to avoid abuse and mass surveillance by state or police. Before we go into the details, I want to recap the notion of anonymity and how it is formed. It's based on a famous 40-year-old idea by David Chaum. He says we establish unlinkability of messages in a communication system using mixes. A mix is a server that takes messages and forwards them. Importantly, at a time, they take multiple inputs and produce multiple outputs. So when you look at one output, let's say the one with the red marker, you do not know which of the two senders has actually sent this message. In practice, mixes usually realize this property by collecting batches of messages. Obviously, you need more than one. Randomizing the order and re-encrypting the contents. The latter ensures that somebody watching the inputs and the outputs cannot link based on bit patterns. Now, it is obvious that the bigger the batch size, the better the anonymity provided by the mix. Every additional input increases the what we call anonymity set. The size of the anonymity set becomes a measure for privacy. But increasing the batch size is not the only way to improve anonymity. Instead, one can also use multiple mixes in sequence, or how we call it, a cascade of mixes. Cascades have the additional benefit that anonymity seekers do not have to rely on a single mix or mixing server. So now, how can we revoke anonymity in this setting? Mixing does not offer anonymity. We say the anonymity set size drops to 1 if either all the mixes of the cascade collude or all other users collude. The first option, collusion of mixes, has been researched for quite some time. Usually, it's done by putting backdoors into the system. Either you give a privileged party access to the mixes themselves, such that they can observe each mix when it happens, or you tweak the cryptography, for example, by introducing a master key that defines the permutation of the messages. Of course, such backdoors are problematic because they might be abused. That's why all of the approaches we list here implement some measures to limit abuse. For example, one can make the backdoors accountable by adding a public counter indicating how many accesses have happened. Or one can add thresholds to the cryptography such that many mixes have to be observed before de-anonymization becomes possible. The problem with all these approaches is that they assume a privileged party that holds some sort of master key that enables de-anonymization. What we have found to be unexplored is whether and how we can transfer revocable anonymity to cryptocurrencies that are built on a philosophy that vehemently rejects the existence of such privileged parties. So let's revise the mixing principle for cryptocurrencies. Again, we want to establish unlinkability, but this time not for messages, but for transactions. Let's replace the messages with transactions. Again, we mark the payment of interest with a red dot. As before, a successful mix ensures that an outside observer does not know where the payment came from. One new aspect is that the cryptocurrency mixes are by design not cooperative. Either the mix operator is not accessible by the typical police officer, or there is not even an operator because the mix itself is a peer-to-peer protocol that leverages cryptography. Independent of the exact implementation, it is safe to say that police cannot expect privileged access to the mix or some sort of backdoored cryptography. In short, law enforcement cannot trace payments as it would be possible for traditional mixes in communication systems. Going back to the last slide, we can safely say that peer-to-peer cryptocurrencies basically ensure that mixes do not collude. Prior work assumes some sort of privileged access, thus it is not applicable to cryptocurrencies. So what else can we do? Well, we already mentioned a second condition for anonymity. If all users collude, the privacy seeker cannot expect anonymity. And in contrast to communication systems, cryptocurrencies record all mixing transactions such that they are publicly visible. Usually this happens on a public ledger. All actors are known. The only missing information is the linking between the inputs and the outputs of the transactions. Consider there was a particularly bad crime happening. Why does law enforcement not simply ask the actors to collaborate on the de-anonymization of the black sheep? We think nothing stops them. Indeed, they should ask, and we think that ordinary mix participants might give up some of their own privacy to enable prosecution of bad crimes. In our short paper, we describe how this collaborative de-anonymization might work in practice. We sketch overlay protocols that enable de-anonymization in Bitcoin and Monero. Both cryptocurrencies work with the so-called UTXO model for transactions. In general, these transactions consist of multiple inputs on the left and multiple outputs on the right. Each input spends an output of a previous transaction. The inputs fund the transaction, and the new outputs on the right allocate the funds to new accounts. Ignoring transaction fees, the M inputs sum up to the same value as the N outputs. So if you do forensic investigation on blockchain, the police sees the public keys associated with the inputs and the outputs, but does not know who controls these keys. For certain kinds of transactions, the police can infer money flow. For example, if there is only one output, or if the values of inputs and outputs allow some kind of inference. There are tools that automatically apply these techniques where possible. However, certain transactions cannot be linked, and exactly these transactions are used as mixes. We focus on two kinds of mixing transactions. First, there are join type transactions, which are implemented, for example, in the CoinJoin protocol on Bitcoin. Here, the idea is that M parties, usually these are M natural persons, provide M inputs for a transaction with M outputs. The inputs and the outputs have indistinguishable value. Thus, for an outside observer, it is not clear which input belongs to which output. We say that the law enforcement does not know the output permutation psi on the inputs 1 to m. The other type of mixing transaction is called ring type transaction and is applied in Monero. Here, there are still m inputs, but only a single output. All of the inputs have the same value, or encrypted value, such that an outside observer cannot infer which of the inputs is the true input sigma. An important difference to join-type transactions is that users can form ring-type transactions without the collaboration of other parties. Essentially, you can just reference other people's outputs as your inputs and thereby increase your anonymity without their collaboration. So for these two types of transactions, we want to study the what we call backtracking scenario. Assume that we have a suspicious cash out on the right. This might be $1 million worth of transactions that is about to be exchanged to cash. You suspect that this money is of illegal origin and you want to trace back the cash flow where it comes from. Here we are looking at ring type transactions, so they all have a single output. And in order to keep my slide simple, I use small ring type transactions where m equals 2. In practice, m would be higher. For example, Monero uses m equals 11. So one of these transactions gives you an anonymity set size of m equals 2. For a criminal, this is probably not enough. Thus, he cascades the transactions such that the outputs of one mix go as input into the next. This cascading causes a major problem for law enforcement. With each additional layer, the number of possible origins doubles. This means that from right to left, the suspect's anonymity set grows exponentially. So what can collaborative de-anonymization do for us? First, we assume some sort of authentic channel that the police can use to contact all, or at least most, of the users that are part of this cascade. We do not go into detail about how this channel might look like in practice. But remember, the public ledger records public keys of all entities. Thus, the police can address the users individually and the users can reply confidentially using their pseudonyms. Now that the participants are aware of the crime, each entity can decide whether to participate in the de-anonymization or not. In our example, the upper entity on the right becomes witness and shares a testimony against the other participant with the police. This testimony removes one half of the suspects. The police can then collect other testimonies until the set of suspects becomes small enough for traditional enforcement techniques. We will now look into how these testimonies might work in practice. We sketch protocols for the two kinds of mixed transactions and also distinguish between individual and group testimonies. The latter are more privacy preserving. But let's have a look at individual testimonies first. We start with join-type transactions. We assume that one of the outputs belongs to the suspicious cash out. We call it the target output T. In this example, T is the first output. The police wants to know which input funds the target output T. Quite obviously, a witness wants to prove that its own input did not fund T. It can do this by revealing the true link associated with its input and output. For example, it could use the two private keys belonging to input and output to sign a challenge provided by the police. The true suspect does not have access to the witness's keys and thus cannot sign the challenge. The police learns one true link that is not associated with the target output. The anonymity set of the suspect is reduced by one per individual testimony. For ring type transactions, the story is a bit different. They only have one output. The witness just has to prove that its input was not funding the transaction. Remember that each cover input is an output of a previous transaction. Here, I use O to denote the spent output of the blue transaction. The witness can uncover the cover input by provably spending the output O somewhere else. It can do so by creating a third transaction that tries to double spend O and send it to the police. The double spending transaction obviously cannot enter the blockchain. Thus, we call it a phantom transaction. Just like the nodes running the consensus protocol, the police can recognize the transaction as a double spend and thus learns that O was spent somewhere else. Again, the anonymity size of the suspect is reduced by one per individual testimony. This is the basic idea of collaborative de-anonymization. I think it is pretty simple, and we are surprised that it was not already proposed elsewhere. One problem that remains with this scheme is that the police learns more information than necessary. Essentially, witnesses reveal one link per individual testimony to law enforcement. The anonymity set size of each witness drops to one. Group testimonies offer a way to reduce the amount of revealed information. The basic idea of group testimonies is that all the M-1 witnesses coordinate on a single testimony that maintains the anonymity set size at M-1, while reducing the anonymity set size of the true suspect to 1. With group testimonies, the police learns one link for their investigation, but nothing else. For joint type transactions, it works as follows. Law enforcement establishes a communication channel between the witnesses. The public ledger records the public keys of all witnesses, thus they can communicate confidentially. Now, law enforcement provides a challenge to the group. Each witness signs the challenge with the private keys belonging to one input and one output. Then, the group sends the resulting testimony with 2 × M-1 signatures back to the police. By counting signatures, the police can infer which M-1 inputs belong to the M-1 outputs that are not the targeted output T. The remaining input must be associated with the targeted output T, and the police learns exactly one link. Group testimonies for ring-type transactions are a bit more involved. They are based on prior work on so-called provably spent sets. The idea is as follows. Consider you have a set of M-1 ring-type transactions, and all inputs belong to a set of at most M-1 distinct previous outputs. Additionally, none of the M-1 transactions is a double spend. Then all of the M-1 inputs must have been spent in exactly these M-1 transactions. Remember that an individual ring type testimony proves that one input was spent elsewhere. With provably spent sets, a group of witnesses can testify that all their inputs have been spent elsewhere. Again, the police learns one link, but the anonymity within the group of witnesses is preserved. In our paper, we sketch a few more details, but I want to emphasize again that we do not provide complete protocols. What we provide is more an argument that privacy-preserving group testimonies are feasible and worth investigating. Next, I want to discuss the potential risk of false testimonies. So, how much confidence can law enforcement place into the testimonies it receives from the witnesses? It turns out that here lies another important difference between the ring type and joint type transactions. Ring type transactions, as implemented in Monero, commit a true link to the public ledger. The commitment is needed to prevent double spending. The true link is stored in obfuscated form. However, it can be inferred unambiguously from the testimonies. even if the true suspect controls all witnesses' private keys, it cannot forge a false testimony. This guarantee is much stronger than what we have for coin-join transactions on Bitcoin. Here, the public ledger does not record a commitment of the permutation psi. Hence, a perpetrator gaining access to a witness's private key can frame this witness with a false testimony. Independent of the type of transaction, we want to note that under collaborative de-anonymization, private keys remain sensitive even if they do not control funds anymore. Witnesses can use their private keys to enable enforcement of bad crimes in the future, even if there is no collaborative de-anonymization protocol in place yet. For joint-type transactions, the situation is quite daunting. Criminals can use private keys of their mixing partners to produce false testimonies. Serious criminals might try to compromise benign participants' keys. In addition, a false testimony unfolds its full power if there is no conflicting true testimony. Thus, in the end, there might be a small physical risk when participating in coin joins today. In our short paper, we elaborate on that a bit further. We also sketch how the tracing could look in the other direction, so forward tracking instead of backward tracking, as we used it in the example earlier. We relate our work to other enforcement techniques, such as blacklisting, and we touch on how the police might obfuscate their de-anonymization requests. Even more interesting for the upcoming discussion might be the aspects that we did not touch in this paper. How might a legal framework for collaborative de-anonymization look like? Which provisions have to be made such that the police can contact individual witnesses? How does it work across borders? And how can potential witnesses be incentivized to provide testimonies and not just remain silent? And if collaborative de-anonymization becomes a norm, how does it affect the ecosystem and the participation in mixes? Does it actually prevent crime? All right, let's sum up. We think that revocation of anonymity by collaboration of users has been overlooked so far. We think that collaborative de-anonymization can help law enforcement and might be leveraged to prevent crime. We have protocols sketched that leave full autonomy to witnesses about whether they collaborate or not. Thus, unlike conventional traffic analysis on blockchains, collaborative de-anonymization does not scale to mass surveillance. We think that our proposal is compatible with the peer-to-peer spirit that drives the cryptocurrency space, and we conclude that collaborative de-anonymization softens the tension between anonymity and law enforcement in distributed systems. With this, we are at the end of my presentation. I want to thank you for listening, and I am looking forward to the discussion in the workshop. If you cannot make it to the workshop, please reach out to me directly or to one of my colleagues.